Good morning, Knicks Nation. I hope everybody's healthy today. I hope you are COVID-free. And if you happen to be unfortunate enough to have gotten this latest evil disease, I hope you overcome it and I hope your family as well. Happy Friday to you all as we're getting ready to head into the weekend. I'm very excited because I've been disappointed thinking the Knicks were going to get into this, you know, into the 5-on-5 scrimmages and team camp, but that's not going to start until tomorrow. And while I won't be looking at it tomorrow, I'm very much going to catch up to all the news tomorrow night and on Sunday. So first off, before we begin, shout out to CP and Jay Ellis, Knicks Fan TV, and Nick of Time Show. What a show they had on last night. They had Alan Hahn from MSG on there last night. It was fire last night. And those of you that were there saw it was fire last night. And then also while I'm doing that, shout out to Sim, from Nothing But Knicks. I'm actually lately been doing, joint shows with him on Tuesday nights. So y'all might want to check that out also. But shout out to my brethren who are, you know, supporting Knicks Nation, who are doing what they do for Knicks Nation. So today I want to talk about the Knicks laying the gauntlet down at the point guard spot. We had this discussion last night, but I want to really bring some things up. First off, because a lot of people, how can I put this? Well, like for regard to my videos, they will watch part of it and not the whole thing and then make comments that are actually answered in the video. But I notice people do that in general. I think it's just a generational thing. There's so much social media and so much media. People just barely look at something or barely listen to it and don't catch the whole thing. For example, let's just go over some basic things. Tom Thibodeau is our coach. Tom Thibodeau stresses defense. Okay. Tom Thibodeau said during his press conference, among other things, that defense keeps you in games and that yes, he's going to be stressing that. Okay. You've also seen this if you've watched his history. This is not my opinion. This is history. If you saw his history at both Minnesota and Chicago, that's what he did. He also said he's looking for players that will add to winning. The key thing here is winning. And I stress to you all this because many people are into this NBA 2K age and they just look at stats and think, oh, you know, this is all that matters. If stats is all that matters, Julius Randle's 20-10 would have led us to the playoffs last year. But it didn't. Because he's a net negative when he's on the court, even though he averages 20-10. Okay? Bringing us to the point guard situation. So at point guards, we know we have Dennis Smith Jr., Elfrid Payton, possibly Miles Powell, although he's more of a shooting guard, possibly Emmanuel Quickley, but I also say he's more of a shooting guard than a point guard. So really, it's Dennis Smith Jr., Elfrid Payton, Frank Ntilikina. They say Austin Rivers is a point guard, but if you've actually seen Austin Rivers play since he's come out of Duke, he's not a point guard. He is also an off guard. Okay? These guys like Rivers, and I don't know Quickley and Powell because they haven't played in the NBA, but they're undersized off guards that can sometimes play the point. Okay, that's really what they are. So the Knicks really have three point guards. Now, let's talk about each one. First off, before I even go there, let me just tell you all this. As I have said before, and I'm going to say it again now, Thibs is not playing games. Okay, I mean, camp is going to decide who's going to play. Okay, he's going to put these kids through the hard this camp they've ever been through, literally. And that's going to decide who's going to play. Okay. So we can all have opinions about who we think is going to play, but that doesn't matter. And all of you that keep putting up like, you know, your best five based on offense, you didn't get the memo. You didn't get the memo. He's focusing on defense, y'all. Okay? So, that's what we're going to be dealing with. So at the end of the day, it is what it is. And this is the first coach, like I said, since Pat Riley, that we're talking about Frank today. But if he was to make a decision that Frank is not good for the team, okay. I'm a Knicks fan. Although I believe if you put Frank on Golden State and do the Google search, they wanted him. Golden State wanted him this past summer and last year. Okay. Champions wanted him. Or you put him on Popovich's team in San Antonio. Or you put him with Miami and Spoelstra. You'll be watching him lock down players in the playoffs. That's what you're going to see. Okay. But he's more than that. And we're going to talk about that. But that's what so I'm saying if Thibs decides, hey, listen, we need to move on from Frank Ntilikina. I'm not going to complain. I trust Thibodeau that much. Okay. I'm going to trust his judgment. I'm going to trust the staff's judgment on these things. Okay. I'm going to do that, but I don't think they're going to do that. And that's what I'm saying. I don't think they're going to do that. They're going to keep Frank. They're going to extend him. He's going to become the first. Listen to me now. He's going to become the first Knicks guard drafted by the Knicks. Okay. Since Charlie Ward to sign an extension with the Knicks. I'm predicting that. Okay. That's what he's going to do. They're going to sign him to extension. How much? I don't know. But they're going to sign Frank Ntilikina to an extension at some point between now and June. Okay. They're going to do that. Okay, he's going to become the first Knicks guard to do that, which tells us something about the organization, really, more than Frank, okay? So, that being the case, let's talk about the guards. So, Dennis Smith Jr. was drafted the same year as Frank, okay? So, I'm going to look at Dennis Smith Jr. Where is it? Dennis Smith Jr., okay? He's drafted by Dallas, same year as Frank, okay? In Dennis Smith Jr.'s rookie year with Dallas, this is his rookie year with Dallas, okay? He started 69 games, his rookie year. He started 69 games. He averaged 30 minutes per game. He shot the ball 15 times per game, okay? He averaged 31% from 40% from the field overall. He shot 69% from the line, averaged 15 a game. Yeah, 15 a game when 15 shots is not very efficient. But the point I'm making is he started 69 games and played 30 minutes a game in his rookie year. Can somebody tell me, when did Frank start 69 games and play 30 minutes a game? I'll tell you. Never. His rookie year was with Hornacek. And Hornacek was breaking him in slowly while Hornacek looking over his shoulder at Frank, Phil Jackson, and Frank got to look over his shoulder at Hornacek. That's the different situation. Okay? So, Dennis Smith Jr.'s second year in the NBA with Dallas. He was traded before his second year was over. But while he was still in Dallas, he started 32 games. He played 28 minutes per game. He shot the ball 11 times per game. Okay. His free throw percentage was 70%. He shot 34% from three and averaged 13 a game. Again, how many times did Frank start 32 games and get to play almost 30 minutes a game? None. None. Because his second year was under another knucklehead named Fizdale. And by the way, Frank started with Hornacek, ended up with Kurt Rambis, and then had David Fizdale, and then had Mike Miller. Frank has had four coaches in 3 years. Now, something else came up about Dennis Smith yesterday on the show that I did not know, that I was a little surprised about, but I should have thought about this. Dallas Mavericks head coach is a championship coach, okay? The Dallas Mavericks head coach is a former Celtic player. is a former Celtic player, Rick Carlisle. I remember him in college. That's how old I am. But he don't play, Rick Carlisle. He demands a lot of his players. That's why Dallas, even when they got not so good rosters, are always in the playoff conversation, because he knows how to coach, okay? And apparently, he was hard on Dennis Smith Jr., and Dennis Smith Jr. didn't take it very well. I knew, I had heard there were some issues going on with him. I thought it had to do with his playing time. But as I'm expressing this to you now, he is getting a lot of playing time. It wasn't his playing time. So apparently, Rick was riding him a little bit, and he didn't like it. Well, let's just say that's a couple of years ago. You know, now Dennis Smith Jr. is 22, actually 23. Maybe, you know, maybe he has learned since then, because Thibodeau is harder than Rick Carlisle. Okay. But point is, Frank never got to start a total of 91 games, or actually as it stands here, 101 games over 2 years and play 30 minutes a game and play through his mistakes. He's never had that opportunity. Okay. When Dennis Smith Jr. came to New York, he started 18 games, played almost 30 minutes a game, averaged 15 a game, shot 29% from three, put up 14 shots a game. Very inefficient. That's called development and playing through your mistakes. When did Frank get that opportunity? I'll tell you when. Never. Okay? Now let's talk about Elfrid Payton. Let's talk about Elfrid. Well, you know what? We don't need to talk about Elfrid Payton. Elfrid Payton is what he is. This is Elfrid Payton's, this is Elfrid Payton's, what is, this is his sixth or seventh year? Seventh year in the league? His seventh year in the league. And he is what he is. Elfrid Payton is a very good point guard, a backup point guard, but he's a very solid point guard. He's not a good shooter. His career, in his 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, his 7 years, 29% from three. But even worse than that, he shoots 63% from the line. I mean, last year he shot 57% from the, 57% from the line on two attempts a game. Okay. But he's a good passer. You know, he averages, averages 7 assists. We know he, you know, he does low-key triple-double sometimes. He put the ball up 10 times a game last year and shot 44% from the field. And again, like I mentioned last year, he shot 20% from three and 57% from the line. But he's a good defender, okay? Frank's floor is better than that. And Frank's ceiling, of course, is better than that. So let's talk about Frank. I have a son. And this is my second oldest boy. And when he was 3 years old, he could not ride a two-wheeler. Right? But if I was to judge him on his ability to ride a two-wheeler when, by the time he was 5 or 6, on his 3-year-old abilities, I would say he's never going to be able to ride a two-wheeler. But by the time he was 6, he had been riding a two-wheeler, was doing inline skating and everything. Because why? Because he developed. Yeah, he grew over the 3-year period. Many of y'all are talking about Frank as if you're still looking at him as a rookie. And by the way, while I'm talking about this, what the hell is all this about this deer in headlights garbage I be hearing from people? Will y'all stop like picking up narratives and just throwing them out and don't know what you're talking about? Frank ain't scared of no damn basketball game. Look, you know he's from Rwanda, right? His family from Rwanda and escaped the genocide where people was getting chopped to pieces with machetes. The boy ain't scared of no. Did you see him put his elbow in LeBron's chest when LeBron pushed him? Did you see him step in front of James Harden and James Harden got so frustrated and pushed him and got an offensive foul? Frank ain't scared of no damn basketball. This deer in headlights stuff, I wonder where y'all getting this from. Frank ain't scared of no basketball game. Stop it. Anyway, y'all judging Frank based on when he played under Hornacek, then Rambis, than Fizdale. What you want to do with Frank is look at his last part of last season, because that's he's progressing. Okay, his shooting numbers went from 29% from three to 32% from three. At the end of last year, in fact, last year, he was shooting 52% from corner threes. The last half of last year, he shot 44% on catch and shoot threes. He's progressing. That's what you want to see with a developing player. Okay? Defensively, we already know what he could do. For his position, the Knicks are 4.6 points better when he's on the floor his rookie year. That's in the 86th percentile. 86th percentile for point guards. His second year, they were 1.2% better, 63rd percentile. And last year, 3.4 points better on defense when Frank is on the floor. That's what you call winning basketball. You see, looking at 6 points a game ain't going to tell you that. You need play at his floor right now. Frank is a winning piece on a championship team. Like, you know, like if you look up Rick Fox, y'all, some of y'all remember Rick Fox. He played for the Celtics and he played for the Lakers. He was never a double figure scorer, really. Yet he's a championship piece. He got rings because he's the type of piece that adds to a champion. That's what Frank is. That's his floor. Okay. But last year, if you notice, like RJ, who was in his rookie year, was playing his best ball in the second half of the year. Did you notice that? RJ was playing his best ball in the second half of the year. It's not coincidental that Frank was also playing his best ball at the end of last year. You know why? Because Frank and RJ play very well together. Okay. At the end of last year, Frank was shooting. I mentioned to you, he was averaging 9.5 points a game on 44% shooting from the field, 35% from three on 22 minutes a game, 22 minutes a game. Frank has never gotten 30 minutes a game. That's why I'm excited about Thibodeau. Because if Frank makes the rotation, and like I said, that's up to Thibodeau. I believe he will because of all the attributes I just named. If Frank makes the rotation, he's going to get 30 minutes a game. And if he gets 30 minutes a game, number one, at the end of last year, he was being much more aggressive offensively with the basketball. He started adding a floater to his game. Okay. You're going to see him get more aggressive this year. Okay. He's 22. He's still young, but he's not a kid because he's been playing pro since he was 15 and he had to get used to being in New York with all you people. And so now he is. He's much more mature. So he's going to be more aggressive offensively. His shot has been improving. He was up to 30, like I said, 35% at the end of last year, from three. Now, if I was to tell you that Frank was going to average 35% for the year from three, you'd be, most of you that know basketball would say, oh man, that'd be good. I think he's going to average about 36, 37 this year. Okay. He's still going to be locked down on defense. Why? Even more so now because he's playing for a defensive coach. And let me also mention this to you. Kevin Knox, if you saw Kevin Knox's interview, he said Thibs was on him all summer to get in shape and improve defensively. And by the way, Knox is very confident. I haven't seen Knox be this confident in his 3 years in the league. He's confident that he's built himself up. He's confident that he's going to come in. And he said he wants that starting position at the small forward. That's what he said. I hope he gets it. Obi said the same thing, though, that Thibodeau and Kenny Payne were working him on conditioning, which he's setting team records in conditioning, and that they want him to be ready on defense. You see, that's how much Thibodeau is stressing defense. As much as Obi is an offensive force, he's going to come into the league as an offensive force. He will not play if he's not playing defense. And that's the same with everybody on the team. So Thibodeau, the criteria is defense. Frank brings defense. And I heard Alan Hahn talking about, well, he didn't mention Frank and he had time to look at tapes. He surely saw Frank's tapes. He must not be impressed. That's BS. That's BS. As I mentioned to Mr. Hahn last night, he said, well, I talked to all three of his coaches. Actually, Frank has had four coaches. And them bums he talked to, who says they know what they're talking about? And I said to Mr. Hahn, let Frank start at least 20 games and get 30 minutes a game before you telling me what he cannot do. Can we do that? And that's why, again, I'm excited about Thibodeau. If Frank makes this rotation, he's going to play 30 minutes a game. He's going to be on the floor. He's going to be more aggressive this year. His shot is improving. Okay? And we're going to see improvement on the statistical level as well as an already solid defender becoming an elite defender under Tom Thibodeau. Okay? That's what we're going to see. So, all you haters, first off, I've been married for 36 years, all right? 36 years to the same woman. And let me tell you something, what I have learned in my 36 years with the same woman. Women always want to have the last word. And so it took me about 20 years to realize, even if I think she's wrong, let her have the last word. Just let it happen. Don't say anything else. Okay? Because a woman is always going to want the last word. And then I've noticed it too, like when I'm doing on YouTube, doing my YouTube channel, both the Knicks and, well, especially my Bible study, they want to come on and call themselves trying to teach me something. And we'll just keep going back and forth, back and forth. And I realize, wait a minute, don't answer anymore. She just wants to have the last word. And then when I let that happen, that's the end of the conversation. Okay? Some of you fellas act like the women. When we talk about Frank Ntilikina, you want to keep arguing the same old points. He can't shoot. Frank is trash. Don't know nothing about basketball, about defense, about win shares. Okay? Because that's what we're talking about. We're talking about long-term, sustainable winning. We're not looking at NBA 2K and plugging people in based on their NBA 2K rating and their per-game averages and points. And y'all want to keep going back and forth with these same old tired arguments. And you know what? I just say, sisters, I'm going to let you have the last word. I'm not going to say nothing to you. For what? What's the point? That's why some of y'all will say stuff on my YouTube page and make stupid comments. And you'll notice I won't say anything to you, but maybe I'll say thank you for your comment and I won't say anything else. Because, sister, I'm going to let you have the last word. Ain't no need. You know what his sanity is, right? Doing the same thing and expecting a different result? Nah. Nah. Okay? So, this year, again, we have a coach that knows what the hell he's doing. And I trust him. And so, if he decides Frank is not going to be in the rotation, hey, I'm a man. And one thing I've learned as a man, you admit when you're wrong. If I'm wrong, I say I'm wrong. I have no problem. But if Frank balls out this year, how many of you brothers, sisters posing as brothers gonna come on and say you was wrong? I wonder. Anyway, I expect Frank to be a starter. I expect him to start in front of Elfrid Payton. If he doesn't, I expect him to be the first guard off the bench. He's going to be in the rotation because he's a defender and he's going to be improving. But you know what? I ain't got to argue with nobody about that because, like I said, camp is going to tell us. Thibodeau is going to show it in camp. He said he wants players that will contribute to winning. One thing I want you to understand, all the veterans that the Knicks have signed that for the 1 year, $5 million deals, or three as it is in Austin Rivers' case, none of these guys are starters. If you were to start all these guys, we'd probably be with 20 wins again. They're just pushing the youth. So Elfrid Payton's going to push Frank to come in and be aggressive. And I like that. I think Frank, the young man from Rwanda through France, is going to pass that test. I also think Obi Toppin is going to pass that test. I also think Mitchell Robinson, he laid the gauntlet down on Mitchell Robinson by talking about Noel. Talent-wise, I think Mitch is going to respond. I hope he doesn't get upset and then withdraw. I don't see that in him, though. I think he's going to respond positively to the challenge and come in and put people in check on the floor. So I think Mitch is going to respond. I think Opie's going to respond. And of course, I believe RJ is going to respond. What am I saying? Well, my starting five that I'd like to see, because I think they're going to come out of this camp and show that they deserve to play, is Frank, RJ, Kevin, Mitchell, and Obi. That's what I'd like to see. Okay? Because Kevin, I believe he has worked this whole summer, and plus, you know, the extra time, he has had time to think about Kenny Payne. He mentioned Kenny Payne makes me come out my comfort zone. That means Kenny forces him to get a motor. If that's the case, my man Kevin's going to be ready to play. Okay? And the vets that we got are going to do what I think they can't, what was sent to here to do. Support the youth and be ready to step in if somebody don't show up. Okay? But the starters are going to get 32, 33, 35 minutes a game, sometimes 40 minutes a game. And so is like them first two people off the bench. You're going to see them all getting 30 minutes. Okay? That's a good thing. So with my man Frank, like I said, camp will tell us everything. When they come out of camp, the first game is the 22nd of December. Okay? When they show up that night for the game, we're going to see who made the cut. Okay? We're going to know who made the cut. Who's going to be the man's? Who's going to play? Who's not going to play? And I'm telling you right now, if I'm wrong, I'll say I'm wrong. Okay? I don't think I will be though. I think I'll be all right. I've been wrong in the past. I ain't going to front. I ain't like I'm perfect. You know what? When I first saw Larry Bird at Indiana State, you know what my thought was? I said, man, this cat's going to average like 18 in the league. He can shoot. He's a white boy. He can't play. He's nothing else. He's not going to do nothing, right? That's what I thought. When he came on the Celtics, the first, you know, they hyped him, and he came out and played, and I saw him in like the opening night, the first week of the season that year. I think it was 1979, 1980, something like that. And I seen him getting the rebounds. He didn't seem like he was very athletic, but he got all the rebounds, hitting all the shots. And I said, dad, he might be pretty good, right? Man, by the time that season ended, his rookie year, if the game was close when they played the Knicks and Larry Bird came down the court and got the ball, I was scared. And I realized I was wrong about this white boy. He could play. So I'm not right about everybody. I can tell you that right now. But I ain't gonna front. I ain't made many mistakes, especially in my older years as I've learned, you know, basketball more and coached and, you know, all that. I ain't made many mistakes. So I'm betting Frank Ntilikina is going to come through. Okay. So anyway, let me know what you think. You haters, keep your stuff to yourself. Have a good weekend. Shalom.